Welcome to Sharing for the Social Skeptic, and that's me. Throughout my career, I've been skeptical that social solutions, particularly in the enterprise, could be helpful. I've spent years doing the research and helped customers figure out how to be successful in this area. If you want to find me on Twitter, you can do that at Rob Bogue. Let me do a better introduction of myself. So first of all, I'm a 13-year Microsoft MVP. I'm an author of 25 books, including the SharePoint Shepherd's Guide for End Users, which covers versions from SharePoint 2007 through today. I've got 25 years of industry experience, and I've got all sorts of certifications. I'm really kind of certifiable. More than that, I'm a dog owner, a father, and a husband who loves connecting with people. And in fact, that's the core of what we're going to talk about. So it's time to get this out of the way. In a lot of ways, social is all about the little squirrels. If you've ever seen the movie Up, you know what I mean. It's a distraction. It's something going alongside of what you really should be doing or thinking about. It's those ADHD moments. Now, I think that there is a place for all of this, but as we go through this talk, we'll learn that there are times to be social and there's times to disconnect. I don't want to leave everyone with the impression that we should always be available. We should always have pop-ups and things getting in our way. So my friend Eric Shupp says the meaning of social is, quote unquote, with beer in hand. In other words, a lot of social is about just being present with each other and enjoying each other's company. Now, that works on a personal level, but how do you transform that into a business? How do you make the folks that you work with, the people that you would want to go have a beer with? So to get through that, we're going to talk about a couple of different things. First of all, we're going to talk about matching social to the business. Where does it fit and where doesn't it? And then we'll talk about how do you seed social for success? So we know we want it. We know why we're doing it. How do we make it successful? And then we'll end with this idea of measuring social results. What did we actually get out of our initiative? And that can be tricky at times, but we'll get some of the fundamentals down so that you can actually measure and demonstrate success. First of all, we have to get into a time machine. Well, not a TARDIS or Doctor Who kind of thing, but we need to go back in time and look at the research that's been done about collaboration and social and connecting people with technology. And that starts with Lotus Notes. If you go back and you look at the old research on groupware, it says something very important. Groupware doesn't cause collaboration, it enables it. That distinction between causing something and enabling it is really important because it tells us that just because we implement the technology doesn't mean we'll actually get people to be more collaborative. And social is the same thing. We're not going to magically make everybody like each other. What we're going to do is create the conditions under which people can interact better. So let's talk about how do we match social to the business. We need to understand our clear objectives for our initiative and what we're going to do to be successful. So in this section, we're going to talk about why we're doing this. In particular, we're going to spend some time on employee satisfaction because that's a big driver to employers making money. The second thing we'll talk about is knowledge management. And a lot of folks really want to get a better handle on the value that they have. Then we'll talk about the wisdom of crowds and how that functions and why that could be a powerful outcome of implementing a social solution. And then we'll talk about getting clear. How do we make sure that we're clear about what we're trying to do? And we'll talk a little bit about some of our social options. So let's talk about employee satisfaction. And this is a big thing today. As we have millennials coming into the workforce, we keep hearing millennials demand social. You have to have social. You have to have an app. You have to be on your mobile phone. That's the way they work and they're digital natives and on and on and on. And we'll learn that there's an aspect of that that is true, which is they are more comfortable with technology. They do have a greater desire to be able to interact in different ways, with different modes. But it's also a little untrue in that we've not really changed across generations. And I'll talk about that in a moment. The next thing that I frequently hear is, we're so antiquated with our tooling that we're losing people. Well, the truth is, I know lots of companies that are well-respected, who don't have trouble attracting employees, who are still using Lotus Notes. Now, in case you missed the memo, Lotus Notes hasn't been competitive for 10 years or more. It's not that people are disengaging from the company, that they're leaving, they're going away just because of tooling. It has a factor, but it's not the only reason. The last one is, we can't attract top talent without it. We have to have social to attract top talent. And I have to tell you that as I speak with recruiters and I speak with people who are entering the job market, I just don't hear that. I don't hear that they won't go to a company because they don't have an internal social network. They'll not go because of lifestyle or wages, but it's not that this idea that if you don't have a social network, you're not going to get any new top talent. So I want to walk you through this flow. And as we talk about engagement, we talk about employee engagement, employee satisfaction, it really rolls through this flow. So if we look at this set of things, we're looking at communication satisfaction. And this is an old research study by Downs and Hazen. It's 1977. They put together a questionnaire that asks things. We're going to spend a little more time on that in a second. That flows into employee satisfaction. In particular, Frederick Hertzberg, back in 1987 and before that, said, how do you motivate employees? How do you get them to want to work for you? That leads into employee retention. And employee retention is a big deal. It's one of those things that can cost somewhere between 50% and 300% of someone's first year salary. So we want to drive retention. And ultimately, if we can get people who are satisfied with the job that they're doing, we will retain them more, we'll improve our customer satisfaction, we'll lower our labor costs, and we'll improve our profitability. So let's take a look at communication satisfaction. It really breaks down into eight areas. And first is communications climate. In other words, what does it feel like to communicate? Is it stodgy? Is it formal? Or is it open? Relationship with subordinates. Now, wait a minute. Hang on a minute. Communication satisfaction. Well, the ability to communicate effectively with our subordinates is a key part of our communication needs. The ability to get personal feedback that isn't attacks, it's actually trying to build someone up and develop them, is also important. An organizational perspective of communication. So are we hearing what's important to the organization, what news impacts the organization, not just for my own division, not for just the things I'm doing, but do we feel like we're connected with the organization? There's horizontal communication. So your communications with peers, how easy or hard is it to do that? Your communication with your superiors, is it easy or hard to communicate with them? What about organizational integration? Do you feel like you're integrated into the organization and that you can communicate as well? And then the last one is media quality. Now, all of these things actually lead to the next thing, which is our employee satisfaction, or what Gallup will call employee engagement. Now, this comes from Frederick Hertzberg's work, originally posted in 1968 in Harvard Business Review and was revised in 1987. And what Hertzberg said is, you know, as you're trying to motivate people, as you're trying to keep them, as you're trying to make sure they are engaged, there are a set of things that you need to do. And key to this are things like recognition. Now, recognition is one of those things that you can do socially. It's one of those components of communication, like communicating with your supervisor, the relationship with your supervisor. There's also the relationship with your peers and relationship with subordinates. These are the factors that motivate a person to stay and engage and be productive in an organization. And so if we look at communication satisfaction, that's those factors around communication lead to employee satisfaction and retention, what we realize is that we need to improve the way people communicate. And social is definitely a way to do that in order to drive the end goal of employee retention. So let's take a look at Gallup for a moment. And Gallup's famous for saying that we have only about a third of our employees that are engaged. In other words, they're really bought into the corporate mission. They actually break things down into three different categories. There's the engaged employee, there's the non-engaged employee, and then there's the actively disengaged employee. Now, the thing is, the engaged folks are the drivers. They're the folks that are really driving the organization forward. The non-engaged folks, those are RIP. I mean, retired in place. They're just there. They're present, they're doing the work that's asked of them, but they're not engaged in the corporate mission. The last group of people, which are the actively disengaged people, I like to call those the subversives. These are the people who are sabotaging the organization overtly, covertly, or unintentionally. They're actively not engaged with what the organization wants to do. And if you look at these two pie graphs, you'll see that the world-class organization has a highly engaged workforce, 67%, whereas the engaged workforce in an average organization is only about a third. The more engaged that we can get folks, the more return on investment and the better the organization itself will be. All right, with that out of the way, let's talk about knowledge management and how that can be a powerful factor for doing social. So we often hear, we just want people to share more, right? There's this knowledge hoarding going on in our organization. We just want them to share more. And so that's great, but how do we do it? We also want people to collaborate more, right? Not only do we want them to share the information they have, but we want them to come together and do more things together. Well, for me, collaboration is a loaded word. Collaboration is one of those words that people say, but they don't really explain what they mean. What does it mean to collaborate? You want two people on a document or something else? And so we encourage organizations to really define what they mean by collaboration. And we'll see this again and again through this talk that we want to get clear on what we mean. One of the dictionary definitions for collaboration is to conspire with the enemy. And I don't think any organization really wants that to happen. Peter Drucker originally said something along the lines of culture eats strategy for lunch. So if you've got a knowledge management culture of hoarding, it's going to be really hard to transfer that, to convert that into an organization that shares. One of the things that you can do is use technologies like social technologies to really shift things in subtle ways that people don't really see. I was talking to an organizational change consultant, one of my peers, and he said, you know, there are organizations for which agile software development doesn't work. Well, agile is all about working together and collaborating and sharing knowledge. Well, I know that I need this and working back and forth. Well, what happens in an organization that's contractual based, like the one he was working with at the time, is agile doesn't work because the whole culture is different and broken. And so he's using techniques that are smaller and more iterative to cause the organization's culture to shift, to be more open, more sharing, and more engaged in this idea of we want to work together and help each other out. So if I were to look at the wisdom of crowds, and this idea is the idea of why we would do collaboration, because together we are wiser. In other words, we come up with better solutions together than we could individually. Now, there are a couple of requirements for wisdom of crowds to function. And the first one is a diversity of opinion. If you only have one opinion, well, there's no crowd in that. Everyone has the same idea. The second part is independence. Somebody ought to be able to speak their mind and not fear for their job. This, by the way, is one of the key reasons we have challenges inside of an organization getting to good solutions, because the boss says something and nobody's willing to challenge the boss. The second is decentralization. They need to be able to draw their own conclusion and operate on their local knowledge. I know that X does Y, so I should be able to reach a conclusion on that. I don't have to rely on somebody else to make my decisions for me. And the last part is aggregation. And this is actually where social plugs in. Social allows people to interact and have the diversity of opinion, the independence, the decentralization, and social technologies aggregate all of this information and bring people together. You can also do this through facilitated meetings and through dialogue, but this is an area where social works well. Now, there's a problem with wisdom of crowds, and that is there are two really big failures. And the first one is groupthink, and that one was first used by Irving Janis. And that is that everybody thinks the same. There's no independence, there's no diversity of opinion, and so it becomes a mob rather than a crowd. And the second failure is something called the tragedy of commons, and I want to look at that in a little more detail. So the tragedy of commons literally is a depletion of a shared resource by individuals acting in their own self-interest. And it really refers to, there used to be towns, and in the towns there'd be common ground, and that common ground would grow grass, and you were free to allow your animals to roam and graze on it. Well, that works great, but each person working individually thinks, well, if I buy another cow, I'll let it graze on the common ground, I'll get food, I'll get milk, I'll sell the cow, and that's all great. Right up until the point where everybody does that, and then nobody has any cows because they're all starving to death because there's insufficient common ground to support what everybody needs. This is a bounded reality problem. If you think about systems, the reality of the individual person is bounded to themselves, and they are unable to see the larger factors that are at work. So I want to compare social to email. I'm going to start with email, and the thing about email is email tends to be one-to-one or one-to-many, so it's like a party line at best with a phone. I can talk to one or two people. The people that are engaged in the conversation are the only ones involved, the only ones that can see it, the only ones that can hear it, the only ones that can benefit from the conversation we're having. A good analogous thing to social is a CB radio. If you ever played with a CB radio, Citizens Band Radio, you'll know that you can hear the conversation that's going on with other people. And that's social. That's the ability to get benefit and advantage out of the conversations happening with other people. I'm going to skip over to learning for a second and talk about the work of Marcia Bates. Now, Marcia Bates said that 80% of what we get in life, our knowledge, our experience, is all about being aware. We're not actively looking for something, and we're not directed in a topic. We're just becoming aware of things, and that's about 80% of what we know. And so as we look at social technologies, our objective is not to figure out the 1% or the 5% as we're trying to find something specific, but rather to increase the overall pie by creating more opportunities for us to just be aware of things happening in the organization, of knowledge being developed, and of new ideas. I once was asked, we were driving someplace, and my wife at the time said, hey, do you know what Emerald Isle is? And I'm like, well, yeah, that's Ireland. And she looked at me kind of funny, and I'm like, I don't know how I know that. I don't know that I've ever heard that, but it was something that I had been exposed to at some point in my past, and it just clicked and connected. And that's how all of us work. The more that we can expose ourselves to the different kinds of conversations, the more powerful our learning gets. As we're looking to work with social technologies, we need to get very clear on what we want. We need to pick an objective or a few objectives, a handful of goals, and remain focused on them. If we decide that we want to improve the sales team's efficiency and get them to win more deals, then that's where we need to focus our energy on our social deployment. We need to make sure that we can deliver on what we're saying that we can do. And sometimes that means challenging things. That sometimes means a ritualized dissent about someone coming to us and saying, hey, there's this other idea that's a better idea, and really playing that devil's advocate and trying to push back on them and say, is it really worth shifting off our one or few ideas that we started with? The thing that you should do definitely is plan on measuring every single thing that you try. That can be really, really difficult in a lot of areas, but the idea is that you want to focus as much as you can on how am I going to know that this was or wasn't successful. And you should expect that some of the things you're going to try just aren't going to work. The last little bit about getting clear is don't do something just because. Don't do something just because it's what you're expected to do. If there's some social idea that you've been tasked to implement, but it doesn't have a plausible way of being successful in your organization, just don't do it. I know that sounds obvious, but I've seen so many organizations say, well, yeah, we knew that forums would never work in our organization, but we did it anyway. Social inside of SharePoint and Office 365, there are tons of options from blogs, wikis, updating your profiles, managing instant messaging, ratings, tagging, commenting. There's just so many options for you to do social inside SharePoint, inside the Microsoft stack, and in other technologies. You don't have to implement all of them. In fact, I would say that a key red flag for me is someone saying, we're going to do all of these all at once. It means that they're not focused on what they want to get accomplished and how they think they'll get it accomplished. All right, so that's a good transition into seeding for social success. If you don't want to do everything all at one time, how do you become successful at implementing a social system? Right? How do you leverage the existing infrastructure inside of your organization, the existing relationships, to help drive the social system? So in this section, we're going to talk a little bit about how to eat an elephant. We'll talk about establishing some cultural norms. We'll talk about reward systems, gamification, and emergence, because ultimately social is about the emergence of our network. With my apologies to PETA, there is a way to eat an elephant. And the answer is one bite at a time. As organizations come to me and they say, I want to do social, I'm telling them, go do one thing or go do two things. Don't do 10 things. Try to get to, I'm going to be successful at one little thing and I'm going to grow and expand, rather than having this kind of big bang explosion of, oh, well, now we're all social. It doesn't work. And part of that's because the cultural norms aren't right. Inside of every organization, there are a set of cultural norms. These are things that are just expected inside the organization. And they may or may not make sense to anyone outside it, but inside the organization, this is just the way we do things. So we're going to look at three invisible norms just to get you a sense for the kinds of things that can be happening that you don't even know are there. And then we'll talk about cold start, which is how do you transform the cultural norms into something different? So I want to start with, which side of the mall do you walk on? That sounds like a really silly thing, but I want to ask you this question because I think we all end up with an answer, but we don't know that we have the answer. We just do it. So I'm going to give you just a second to think about the last time you were in a mall and what side you walked on. Got it? All right. If you are in the United States, much of Western Europe, and lots of places where you drive on the right side of the road, it's likely that in the mall, you're walking on the right side of the mall. So you're making this big loop based on the right side. If you're in the UK or other places where they drive on the left side of the road, guess what? Your natural default will be to walk on the left side of a mall. Nobody says that. There's no rules. No police are going to write you a ticket if you walk on the wrong side of the mall. Although the mall cops are kind of scary. There's nobody going to do that, but we just do it because it is the cultural norm that we walk on the same side of a mall as we drive on in the streets. And even little kids will do it. They know this cultural norm, even though they probably couldn't articulate why. So here's our second one. And the question I have for you, is this rude or respectful? Is cleaning your plate, is eating everything on it, rude or respectful? Well, I live in the Midwest, and in the Midwest, you showed your mom and your host that their food was good, that they had prepared it well by eating every last scrap on your plate. We would be eating those little crumbs of crust that are still on the plate, telling them that they did a great job preparing the meal. And if I did that in the Far East, in China, I'd be rude. The culture over there, the unwritten rule is you leave a small amount of food on your plate. And what that does is that tells your host, your cook, that they have provided you with enough. If you don't leave a little bit, it's rude because you're telling your host that you didn't get enough to eat. One more. Everybody rides in an elevator, unless you're completely petrified of them. But when you get in the elevator, what happens? So first of all, you walk in and you immediately turn around. Why is that? You come back and you face the door. And we all do that. If you want to have fun sometime, walk into an elevator that's completely full and keep facing the back wall. it'll freak people out. That's just not the way things are done. Another thing that's interesting is, do you talk in an elevator? Can you and a friend do mid-conversation, walk into an elevator, absolutely stop talking, and then when you get out on your floor, you walk out and you resume the conversation like nothing ever happened? It's like pressing the pause button, and then as soon as you walk back outside, you hit play and you're back on things. These are little bits of culture in the public eye that we take with us that we don't think about, but we just do. It's a part of who we are. And so the challenge for us inside of an organization is, what are those cultural components that we need to move? And how do we deal with this silly cold start problem? How do we get the process of changing started? So the trick is breaking inertia. How do you get things moving? And then how do you keep them moving, right? How do you break that initial inertia so that you can get them going, right? The biggest thing is you need to provide a model for doing it. You need to be able to start people down the path that you want them to walk on. Now, Amazon, which is arguably the best e-commerce retailer, had a problem when they initially introduced the review system. The review system was great, but nobody knew what to do with an online review. And in today's world where we look for social credibility, that sounds completely silly. But in the world in which they started the review systems, it was very much reality. They ultimately had to pay people to do reviews so that they could get the system going and people knew what to expect. And in order to keep that going, they needed to create a reason for people to try it. Again, they compensated people at start, and after that, they're doing follow-up emails to try and get you to do the reviews. They really tried to continue to drive the new behavior they wanted. It's like they took a play out of Everett Rogers' book, Diffusion of Innovations. So Diffusion of Innovations is really Everett Rogers' work around the adoption of farming innovations inside of Iowa and the surrounding states. And during the time that he was doing the research, farming methods were improving productivity substantially. We were multiplying the amount of food that we could get out of the same ground very rapidly. And there were some farmers who were benefiting from that and some who weren't because they weren't adopting. So he started researching, what does it mean to adopt? What does it mean to change your behavior to something new and presumably something better? Well, there are five factors that he identified which are critical to being able to cause adoption to happen very early. By the way, if you've ever seen the bell curve with the early adopters, late adopters, and the innovators, that's all from Everett Rogers' work. So we start, the first factor is relative advantage. There has to be a reason why people want to do it. In the case of social, we need to make sure that they're getting something out of the deal. And that could be they're getting the answers to their questions, or they're getting some sort of a bonus, or they're getting notoriety or something. There has to be some relative advantage to the new idea from the old one. The second is compatibility. Does it work with the way that we've been doing things or against it? The more compatible things are, the better off you are. And then there's our friend complexity. And inside of SharePoint, we've historically had a problem with complexity. Social can also be complex, but the key here is this is actually apparent complexity. You'll notice that a lot of the user interface for social tools is very easy to use. You can drag and drop files, and it's very easy to add things. There's a reason for that. They're trying to hold down the apparent complexity of the social solution. The next is trialability. Can you try it and get back out? Of course, people don't want you to do that right now, but from an adopter point of view, you want to be able to try it and walk back away. Last, we have observability. Can other people see that you're doing it? And in lots of ways, we cross-culturalize our social into things like email that people are using so that the benefits of social are observable to other people. So we need to talk about removing barriers because the barriers, the small barriers, are the things that add up. There's a book called Demand, and in that book, it discusses the growth of Zipcars. And this is a shared usage vehicle, not quite like a rental. It's a membership and then you pay for usage. And Zipcars were having trouble getting people to sign up for their subscription membership. And they were having trouble, it turns out, because the walking distance between where people were and the cars was about 10 minutes. And then they discovered a discontinuity, and that is a huge difference in results based on a small change in input. And they realized that if they move the cars to within a 5-minute walk of people, their subscriptions jump dramatically. And this is one of those things that we look at when we're building social. What are the barriers that are in our way? Some of them hidden, some of them in cultures that are preventing people from doing things. Is it, I don't want to have to call the help desk to get an account set up? Well, figure out how to remove those objections and any potential objections they have so that you can get these barriers out of the way. If you've got teenage kids like I do, you know that a small little barrier will stop them from doing what you have asked them to do. So, for instance, if you say, take out the trash, and later you come back in and it's not taken out, you'll ask your teenager, well, why didn't you take out the trash? And their answer could be, I forgot. We get a lot of that. But we also get, I don't know which trash you wanted me to take out. Okay, well, we always pretty much mean the kitchen trash, but okay. Or, I don't know where the trash bags are. Now, these are the same teenagers who have lived in my house their entire lives, and they don't know where we keep the trash bags for the 100th time. When we're building social systems, we often focus on the reward systems. We focus not on those negatives and getting the barriers out of the way, but we focus on how do we reward them. These are green stamps. And it used to be that you get green stamps for buying things and you could redeem them for products in a catalog. This is kind of the master model for all the things that we do today, like Coke rewards and other opportunities. This is all built on the idea of psychology of value, where there doesn't have to be any real value, there doesn't have to be intrinsic value, but there has to be a perceived value. The idea is that the person is working for some sort of a reward that is useful to them. So, this is a strong human desire to achieve something. In fact, when we looked at Hertzberg's work earlier, we saw that was at the very top of his motivating list. This is those things that really get people to do stuff. You've seen people with these collections and Beanie Babies and stuff. Oh, I've got all of the Beanie Babies and I've got all the this, that, and the other. These systems that work on achievement are very, very powerful. And that's one of the reasons why we lean on them. I can tell you that a $5 Starbucks card, which will buy you maybe one coffee, is a powerful motivator just because people think of the coffee and not the individual dollar amount. So this kind of bleeds into the next topic, which is gamification. So how do we make our social system something that we really want and that people really want to engage with? Well, the thing is that gamification is more than points and badges. It's more than just this simple, oh, well, if I add a badge and I add a couple of points, then poof, I've got gamification and people are going to flock to my social system. Well, that's not really what gamification's about. What gamification's really about is making work seem like play. How do you make work seem like play? Now, let me give you an example. So, geocaching. If you're not familiar with geocaching, it is there are these things put out that you get to go see, and you're led to them by clues and by sometimes by coordinates of a GPS. So the idea is you can go look at something, but you have to leave it there. This is a beautiful example of how we took something, which is work, exercise, going on a walk, going on a hike, and we turned it into play. You think about it, you don't get anything that you get to keep on geocaching. You, oh, yep, there it is. And then you have to leave it there for the next person. Gamification is a lot about how do you take things that aren't play and make them seem like they're play. Gamification builds on flow. And flow is a mental model, it's a psychological construct. Mikhail Csikszentmihalyi came up with this idea of this highly productive state where people are getting things done. They can be five times more productive in this state than any other state of normal work. And it really relies on three key things. First, it relies on clear goals. Now, the clear goals, we've talked about a couple of times, but here, clear goals are more minute. They're finite. They're smaller. They're what does the individual person need to accomplish? And that may be run a mile faster, or maybe something totally different. But the goals themselves are very clear. The second is they need immediate feedback. So they need to be able to tell whether they're doing well or not doing well. And the last, and this is the important part that gamification picks up on, is the challenge to skills ratio. There's an optimal band of about 4% gap between the amount of challenge and the amount of skills of the person that causes people to enter flow. This flow state, again, is highly productive. And so we want to drive more people into flow. We want to challenge them in ways that get them into this state. Now, the counter of this, and one of the things that works against us as we're implementing social, is notifications kill flow. Any interruption will break flow and make it hard to get back in. Some estimates are that it takes 15 minutes to get into flow. Some folks claim you can get into it in 5. Some folks claim you can even trigger it. But in general, we have to look at the idea of how do we get the right challenge to skills ratio to trigger flow to happen, and then not annoy and notify and ping people to death so that they can't stay in it. Let's talk about emergence for a second, because whenever we're building a social system, we're really trying to figure out how to cause things to emerge, except we can't predict every outcome. And there's a story about some missionaries going into Aborigine villages, and they brought with them steel axe heads. And they did this with the hope that they would minimize the pain and suffering of the tribe, because there were only so many axe heads and they were all made out of stone, and they were very precious and needed to be handled. Well, the output of that was a lot of disintegration of their social structure. And because people didn't have to borrow the axe heads, that destroyed a lot of their social culture and had some very negative outcomes for them, right? We are not going to, with our social, predict every outcome. We can be reasonably certain that we're going to get some good outcomes, but we don't necessarily know we're going to get exactly what we're looking for. It's not like we can put a caterpillar into a cocoon and out comes the monarch butterfly. But what we want to do is create the conditions. We want to create the conditions that social can happen in. We want to put the right tools in place. We want to put the right training in place. We want to do the organizational change work so that we can hopefully get to the right answer. Before we close this section out, I need to talk a little bit about systems thinking. That is, that one thing is not just itself, but it's also the connections that relate it to other pieces. And that's really what we're talking about when we're talking about social. We're recognizing that it's not the individual players that you have on your team that are important. What's really important is the relationship the players have with each other. You can have an all-star basketball team or football team or whatever, but they still have to practice together to build relationships so that they can function together. And that's what social technology is designed for you to do with the enterprise. The idea is to make those connections better, to enable new connections to be formed on top of the existing structure. So we're going to wrap up our time today by talking about measuring results. And I don't want you to disengage, because I think this is probably the most important part of doing any kind of social implementation. We need to take the management by objectives, the MBOs, and make sure that they're aligned with what we're doing in social. So what I mean by that is really the reverse of where we started. Where we started was we allow social to support the business objectives. Now what we're trying to do is tie individual objectives, individual metrics into social and driving those outcomes that we want out of the business. So social becomes the transmission that converts the power of the people into the distance that the organization wants. To do that, I need to talk about leading and lagging indicators. And most people, if you're in the United States, are struggling with weight, or at least you're conscious of it. As a nation, we're the most overweight, and where I live in Indianapolis, we don't quite have a corner on the market, but we are quite good at having folks who have more calories on board than they need. And that's really the point. We may be going for an objective of specific weight, which is really designed to our overall health. We're trying to figure out, is our overall health right? But what are the leading indicators for that, right? Once you have a weight, that weight is what you are. How do you manipulate that weight before it gets there? And the answer to that is calories and exercise. How much you eat, what number of calories you take in versus what you burn, ultimately ends up in weight. And so as we talk about how do you set the objectives for individuals, how do you set objectives for your program, we're talking about two different kinds of indicators. Let's start with lagging indicators, because those are the ones that most people understand and are used to. And so whatever the lagging indicator is that you choose, whatever the metric is that you choose, you should want it to represent some business value. There should be some tangible reason why the business wants that to happen. So, for example, we may want to increase the number of sales wins. We may want to reduce the service desk costs or help desk costs, or we may want to improve project profitability. So these are the kinds of indicators that you use to say these are the end goals, these are the places we get. But leading indicators are also a part of the mix, and they're things that you want to use to help guide the ship, because they should reasonably predict the result, not exactly, not always, not every time, but they should reasonably predict the result, and they should be changeable, right? So if the indicator you pick always predicts the result, it's probably not a great leading indicator, because that would be fortune telling, right? You want it to reasonably predict 90% correlation, and you want to make sure that it's something that you can change. Just because you know that the weather tomorrow is going to be 90 degrees doesn't mean you can do anything about it. Some examples of this are response time for RFPs, and RFP stands request for proposal. So if your responses are earlier, then you know that you're going to get a better response out of folks, that when your proposal is turned in anything other than the last minute, it was actually complete. A lot of RFP responses are turned in last minute just because people run out of time. If you want to reduce service desk costs, well, certainly looking at ways to reduce the service desk call times is one way to do that. If you can reduce the call time, then people are spending less on the phone and you have to maintain fewer agents. There's also this idea of project issue closure time. So if I want my project costs to be reduced, then having the issues in a project close individually quicker means that we're going to get a better result. All right, we're going to open it up for questions and answers here in a second, but I wanted to leave you with this. And this is the work that I've done to make SharePoint easier. It's SharePoint Shepherd's Guide, and we've done this since 2007. We have guides all the way up through 2013 and 2016. It'll be available very soon. It also works for SharePoint Online. And as you're thinking about this social problem and how do you enable users, that's what we do here with the licensed version, is we make it self-service so that people can get their own answers. So I want to transition now our conversation from this pre-recorded component to live questions and answers, and I will be rejoining you here in just one moment online. And if you have a moment to put in a question, if you've got anything that you're curious about, get those into the Q&A, and we will start responding to those momentarily. So I want to thank you for participating, and I'm really looking forward to the kinds of questions that you've got here in a moment.